Hi there. Today I'm going to talk about intellectual integrity versus social competence. A matter of doing the right thing intellectually versus doing the right thing socially. Sadly, these two often clash quite a bit. I'm going to talk about the stories that we are constantly building up about ourselves and each other, this thing that I call narrativism. And I might also get into the issue of the meaning of restrictive clothing. My idea about intellectual integrity is my 5x3 compass for reality, which I've been talking about in a previous video. To put it briefly, there are five sets. The first one is three layers of reality that you see the difference between physical reality, internal reality, and social reality. The physical reality we all live in and share. Internal reality is unique to each of us based on the brain that does exist in physical reality. And then social reality is something we weave between ourselves. It is based on all these brains that exist in the world. And the second set is three basic truths about the universe and about each of these three layers of reality. The universe exists, the universe is not a conspiracy, and the universe does not revolve around any specific personal group. And this goes for internal reality as such, as well as social reality as such. Of course, individual personal realities or individual social realities may revolve around whatever, but not on a macro scale, okay? Just because your life revolves around yourself or a certain ideology or religion doesn't make it so for everyone. So please distinguish between your own internal reality, your own social realities, and internal realities for everyone and social realities for everyone. It's not the same thing. And then we have the distinction between words, concepts, and the thing itself, that you don't get those mixed up. That's so easy to do, and then you're just locking yourself in language bullshit. Number four, three universal sources of morality. Respect, maximization of good outcome, and empathy. And finally, the most important one, meaning of life. We have three universal sources of meaning of life. We have the simple truism that whatever is meaningful for you is meaningful. And we also have the same thing applied to other people's internal reality, that if you do something that is meaningful for someone else, then this is also meaningful. But finally, we have the higher level of meaning, where we build meaning together through our stories. We make a story that give meaning and pour meaning into it. And here we have all ideologies and all religions and all that kind of stuff. We have scientific paradigms as well. Not science as such, but the stories we base on science. And the thing is, these stories is something we really need. They give us the chance to make sense of the world, and they give us meaning in the world. but this make them very seductive. It's very easy to get lost in these stories, and this is why we need the entire compass. So this is my idea about intellectual integrity. If you have other ideas, do bring them up. I'm open for discussion. Social competence, on the other hand, that's a matter of doing the socially appropriate thing, of not disrupting the stories around you, but flow with them, be a part of the story, be a person that people like instead of know-it-all or someone who spoils the good mood or anything like that. And social competence, it's a matter of not hurting or putting down the wrong person. Of course, it's also part of this social competence that you should hurt and abandon and be unfair to people whenever socially appropriate. If someone is hated by most people, then you should go with the flow and hate that person as well, and go with the most biased, bigoted stories, and don't disrupt those stories, because that's not a socially competent thing to do. As you might have figured out already, I'm not very fond of social competence. However, my position is not simply that we should choose intellectual integrity instead of social competence. I do think that intellectual integrity is more important and more valuable than social competence, but we do need both. Intellectual integrity without social competence might not be as bad as social competence without intellectual integrity, but both of them are bad. If you go with social competence without intellectual integrity, then you will be a turncoat and a bigot, and you will be that advisor who have the common courtesy to not point out that the emperor is naked. However, with intellectual integrity without social competence, we have two problems. First of all, assuming that your intellectual integrity is without problem, then you still have the problem of getting through to people without needlessly stepping on their toes. Saying mean things just because they're true is not a matter of being honest, it's more a matter of being a jerk. So you need to put some restraint on your intellectual integrity. Use it with a bit of caution and wisdom. And you need to use it in a way that can get through to people. If you get stuck in the right thought, then you can't communicate it to others. And the second problem is the difference between actual intellectual integrity and your own vision of intellectual integrity. Most times, when you feel the need to push something on people, it's not because of actual intellectual integrity, it's because of your own emotional needs. And it's very likely that you gotten lost somewhere and missed at least one of the 15 parts of the 5x3 compass. You see, your intellect, and thus your intellectual integrity, is part of your mind. It is a part of your own personal internal reality. And it can be hard to understand other people's internal reality. Social competence may very often be a shortcut to respecting other people's internal reality, even when you don't understand them. I have encountered some people who are totally stuck in their own mental construct, assigning certain words to certain concepts and certain concepts to certain phenomena, and then build a story around the whole thing. It's all in their own heads, and it may or may not be an interesting story, it may or may not be a useful story, but they believe that their intellectual integrity equals that their definitions of words and concepts and their story has to be the one true reality for everybody. And if you don't understand that, then you're simply not deep enough. And yes, I will make a response to that particular video by Republic of Sandals shortly. But he's not the only one. This is a rather common phenomenon. It's very widespread in politics and philosophy and activism and so on. So he's in very good company. I've been wanting to make this video for quite some time, but some other stuff came between. This word I mentioned, narrativism, it's actually a pre-existing term. My definition of narrativism is about treating life, treating the world as if it was a story, and you're treating people as if they are narrative devices rather than people in their own right with their own needs and their own point of view. The pre-existing term narrativism, it does mean the same thing, but it's about role-playing games, and in that case it's a good thing. There's nothing problematic about treating fictional persons as mere narrative devices. It does become problematic when you treat real people the same way. So anyway, I wanted to do this video for quite some time, but a lot of other stuff came between. But then the other night I saw this new video from YouTube blogger Typhoon Blue, where she kept developing her concept of threat narratives, which I think is a very interesting concept. And like I said in the comment sections, I really would like to see some sources. First of all, some sources that she have used. And second, if she writes something about this, that one could refer to, because I mean, here on my YouTube channel I can refer to another YouTube channel, but if I talk about things in a more serious context, it doesn't look so good to refer to an anonymous person on YouTube. The basic thing here is the division into in-group and out-group, the whole us versus them. And the threat narrative thing that Typhoon Blue is talking about is a specific form, a specific method of building this us versus them, a system of upplaying one side's vulnerability while downplaying bad will and agency. And doing the opposite for the other side. So we have one side that needs to be protected and one side that is clearly the villain. This is a very common narrative structure in fiction and also in how people build their stories about reality. I do think that Typhon Blue exaggerates the importance of threat narratives quite a bit, but I also do think that it is a structure that is real in many ways, that this kind of dynamic do exist quite a lot. And in this latest video, she left behind a bit of the overemphasis on gender. It was this discussion about restrictive clothing and what they mean. One classic narrative about restrictive clothing is that it is something done against women. It's done to remove their agency, make them into objects. By Typhon Blue's model, it is instead a matter of removing their appearance of agency rather than their actual agency. This is a very important distinction, and more importantly, she moved on to start talking about clergy and aristocracy, how rich and famous people and high religious dignitaries and so on do the same thing, use restrictive clothing to point out that they are vulnerable and deserving protection. This is worth exploring further, but I think she has a point when it comes to clergy. But it's not just about being vulnerable, it's also about pointing out that you don't need to work. And this whole thing with vulnerability goes two ways. It can be about deserving protection and needing protection and so on, but it can also be about pointing out that you're so secure that no one will attack you. And I think that might be the main thing with aristocracy, that they are so in control that no one would attack them anyway. And furthermore, how common is restrictive clothing when it comes to aristocrat men? I can see it on some kings, but we also have a lot of knights in shining armor and that kind of routine, carrying ceremonial weapons and so on. So it kind of goes both ways, doesn't it? With clergy, I mean, with aristocracy, I don't think that they want to downplay their agency at all, but I do think that clergy want to downplay their agency. I mean, they are merely servants of a power much higher than themselves. That's the message they want to send. So of course they want to downplay their agency. Bottom line, I haven't really studied clothing throughout ages. I do think it's very interesting with what it means and so on. But one more thing about the threat narratives. On whose terms are these narratives being built? I mean, Typhon Blue claimed that the damsel in distress is the most powerful character because she decides who is the hero and who is the villain. And to some extent, she is correct. There's nothing scarier for a hero character than to have the damsel in distress running away from him. running to the other guy for protection from him. That makes him the villain, and that's exactly what he doesn't want. But how much agency do the damsel character really have? Because there are two basic stories about the captured woman. She may be the still innocent princess who can still be saved, but she may also be the corrupted little whore who need to be killed for her own good. So it can pretty much be two guys fighting over one woman, and she has no other option than to declare the winner the knight in shining armor, whether she likes to or not, because if she isn't his little princess, then she must be the other guy's little whore who the virtuous hero need to kill for her own good. I'm talking about fictional stories here, but I'm also talking about reality. Among other things, this dynamic is one of the biggest problems when it comes to the rights of sex workers, because we have this whole rescue industry bullshit going on with people trying to save people who don't want to get saved, and then get very hostile when these people affirms that they don't want to get saved, that they don't see these people as their savior. This basic thing with having someone after you, someone who demands that you see them as your savior, it's really annoying, and in itself it is not gendered. You, whoever you are who hear this, you probably recognize this narrative from whatever religion or ideology you don't agree with. People who want to save you, want you to see the light, want you to get saved in one way or another because you're so lost without their story. Whatever story they may have, that's the one single truth, and everybody who doesn't have it are lost little sheep in need of guidance. And if they don't accept this wonderful gift, then they are dirty and deserve to be put down. So, this is pretty much all I have to say for now. If you haven't seen my 5x3 Compass for Reality video yet, I recommend it. And I'm curious about your views, so do contact me in one way or another, here on the comment field or in private mail or in whatever form this pops up. So, until next time, have a good time and live long and prosper.